Hello everyone, in this video we'll be discussing about the gypsum material. So first let's start with the classification. So there are five categories of the gypsum materials. Type 1 being the impression paste. So this is the dental plaster impression, so it is also known as the impression plaster, and it is a type of mucostatic type of impression material. Then we go to type 2. So this type 2 is dental plaster model. This is generally used for making the diagnostic casts. Then we can use it as articulating material or for attaching the articulators to the cast to the articulators, and we can also use as filling materials in investments, right? So in investing procedures also we can use this particular type of dental plaster model. Now the type 3, known as the dental stone, so this thing, the model, this thing is class 1 stone also. So we can call it as class 1 stone to the type 3 dental stone. Then we have type 4, which is also known as class 2 stone, and type 5 is known as class 3 stone. Now the type 3 dental stone, it is used for making the final cast or the master cast. Then type 4, the dental stone die, high strength but low expansion. And then we have some modification of this type 4 in which we get the high expansion. So the type 5 is dental stone with high strength and high expansion. Now let's start with the type 1. So this type 1, known as the dental plaster impression, right? So it is also known as impression plaster, as well as we call it as soluble plaster. I'll tell you why. So this impression plaster was one of the earliest impression material which was discovered in the dentistry and has been used since long time. And it is a type of rigid impression material. Since it is rigid impression material, it cannot be used in the dentulous areas as well as in the areas where there are lot of undercuts. So this is rigid material and it can be fractured while removing from the undercut areas in the mouth. Then the impression plaster, sometimes it contains potato starch. So what is the function of this potato starch? It helps in easy dissociation of this impression material from the cast, right? So after the cast has been hardened, the impression and cast both are put in hot water, and the starch, the potato starch, swells and the impression will disintegrate, making it easy to separate from the cast. So this type of impression material, due to this particular solubility property, is known as the soluble plaster. Now the type 2 gypsum material, that is the plaster, so the dental plaster here is used for making the models. So the important uses here are, we can make the study cast and models. Then we can of course make mores while investing the material, as I'm investing materials for the dentures and for mounting cast on articulator. So it basically composed of the hemihydrate and the other modifiers. Then we have the type 3, that is dental stone. Other name can be class 1 stone, as we have already discussed, and it is also known as hydrocal. Now this particular stone contains alpha hemihydrate, while the type 2 contains the beta hemihydrate. That is the basic chemical difference between these two. The compressive strength is higher than the dental plaster, and it is around 3000 to 5000 psi, and setting expansion of the dental stone is 0.06% to 0.12%, and the hardness is 82 RHN. Now the type 4 gypsum material, which is also known as the type 2 dental stone or the die stone, high strength, low expansion. Why do we call it die stone? Because it is used for making the dies. So it is strongest and the hardest variant of the gypsum product, and dies used for inlay, crown and bridge wax patterns. All these that can be used for the this can be used for making the dies, right? Now the die stone should be separated 1 hour after pouring. That means that should be like in the contact of the impression for at least 1 hour, right? Now we have the type 5, that is the dental stone, high strength, high expansion. So what is the benefit of this high expansion? The basic benefit of this high expansion is that it compensates the shrinkage of the base metal alloys, right? So this is most recent gypsum product, and it is having good high strength, and sometime it is considered that it is having better compressive strength even than the Tri-4 stone. Now this is to compensate for the shrinking of base metal alloys. Now let's see the manufacture process of the gypsum product. So the reactant or the raw material we take is the calcium sulfate dihydrate, and we heat it at 110 to 130 degree Celsius. So it loses some amount of water, and the product we have is the calcium sulfate hemihydrate. If we further heat this particular hemihydrate at little higher temperature of around 130 to 200 degree Celsius, then it will be losing all its water and it is formed as calcium sulfate. So this is hexagonal form. Now the anhydrite can further change into the orthorhombic anhydrite if it is heated at higher temperatures around 200 to 1000 degree Celsius later. So the process of heating gypsum for the manufacture of plaster is known as calcination. So this process is basically known as calcination here, right? Then when heated, gypsum, that is calcium sulfate dihydrate, loses part of water of crystallization and changes to the sulfate hemihydrate. So here 1.5 part of the water of hydration is lost, or the water of crystallization is lost, and half part is only remain. Now on further heating, the remaining water of crystallization, that is half water, will also be lost, and that will lead to formation of hexagonal anhydrite. If you further heat it at around temperature 200 to 1000 degree Celsius, then that will be forming the orthorhombic anhydrite. Now let's see the manufacture of these gypsum products. So first of all, we'll be having the calcium sulfate dihydrate as our raw material. And now for this, we can have two techniques, two basic techniques. One is the dry calcination in open. We'll use the open vessel for this, and another is the wet calcination. Now in the dry calcination, we'll be heating the calcium sulfate dihydrate at around 110 degree Celsius to 130 degree Celsius, and we'll get the calcium sulfate hemihydrate, right? And this is basically the beta hemihydrate. When we do the wet calcination in a closed vessel under some pressure, then also we get the calcium sulfate hemihydrate, but that is the alpha hemihydrate. So this is the basic difference between two. And the second basic difference, here the temperature was 110 to 130, while here the temperature will be around 120 to 130. Okay, so this is how the manufacture of dental plaster works, dental plaster as well as dental stone works. So the gypsum is ground and it is heated in open kettle or kiln at a temperature of around 110 to 130 degree Celsius, and this process is basically known as the dry calcination. So beta types of crystals are formed, and microscopically you will be seeing the needle like more irregular type of crystals. So here is the reaction of the whole process. Calcium sulfate dihydrate is heated at 110 degree to 130 degree Celsius, and beta hemihydrate is obtained. Same way manufacture of dental stone is done, just we use the wet calcination method. When I say wet, so you should understand that some water is being used here. So this water is incorporated into the alpha crystals, and that's why we call it hydrocal. So this is the another name for the dental stone. So the gypsum is calcined under the steam pressure in an autoclave around 120 to 130 degree Celsius at 17 lb per square inch for 6 to 7 or sometimes 6 to 8 hours, right? So you'll be getting the alpha hemihydrate, which will be having the crystals like rods and prism, and these are more regular. And since we already had incorporated the water in the manufacturing process, that's why they will require less amount of water than the beta hemihydrate to be converted back to the calcium sulfate dihydrate. Now if we want to manufacture the high strength
alpha modified stone, so we'll be using the gypsum, and that is calcined by boiling at 30% calcium chloride solution, or it can also be autoclaved in the presence of sodium succinate if we use more than 1% of the sodium succinate. So the crystals we'll get will be the cuboidal in shape, and we can have the following setting reaction. We'll have the hemihydrate and we'll add water to it, that will be forming the dihydrate, and some unreacted calcium sulfate hemihydrate is left, and it is a exothermic reaction, so that will be releasing some heat also. So this is the reaction for the manufacture of high strength alpha modified stone basically. Now there are several theories which have been proposed for the setting of the gypsum. The important theories are colloidal theory, then we have the hydration theory and dissolution precipitation theory. So we'll be reading about these theories now. The colloidal theory states that there is a interplay of the sol gel mechanism in the setting of the gypsum. So what generally happens, there is a sol gel mechanism, right? So the sol will be here calcium sulfate hemihydrate. When it is mixed with water, it forms a sol which is converted to the gel and gives a solid calcium sulfate, right? So that is known as the gypsum, right? So this theory proposes that when mixed with water, the hemihydrate will be entering into the colloidal state through a sol gel mechanism. Now in the sol state, the hemihydrate will be combining with water to form a dihydrate, that means it will be entering into an active state, and as the water is consumed, the mass will be turning out to be a solid gel. Same way we'll have the hydration theory. Now this hydration theory simply says that the hemihydrate which we are using, if extra water is mixed in that water will be making forming the hydrogen bonding with the sulfate group, and that will give rise to a solid mass. So what will happen, there will be calcium sulfate hemihydrate, and if it is mixed with water, so this water will be forming hydrogen bonding with this sulfate, and then it will be forming a solid mass. So it suggests that the rehydrated plaster particles will join together through the hydrogen bonding to the sulfate groups to form a solid mass. Now the next and the most accepted theory is the dissolution participation theory, which is also known as the crystalline theory. Now what is important about this theory is we should know basic things about hemihydrate and the gypsum which we get, right? Now this hemihydrate is 4 times more soluble than the gypsum. Now when it gets water, of course it will be converting into the gypsum. So what will happen, this gypsum being less soluble, it will be precipitating out. So once the gypsum is precipitated out, it is out of the reaction. Again the calcium sulfate hemihydrate will be reacting with water, forming the gypsum, and this gypsum will be again precipitating out. So this will continue the formation of gypsum until or unless the whole calcium sulfate hemihydrate and the water is exhausted. So here the theory is most widely accepted. According to this theory, plaster will be dissolving and will be reacting to form the gypsum crystals, and these will be interlocked to form the said solid. Now the hemihydrate is generally 4 times more soluble than the dihydrate. So when the hemihydrate will be mixed with water, it will be forming a workable suspension. So there will be a fluid suspension which will be formed. Now these hemihydrate will be dissolved until it will be forming a saturated solution. Once the saturated solution is formed, some dihydrate is formed due to the reaction. Now the saturated hemihydrate will be super saturated with respect to the dihydrate, and next what will happen, the dihydrate will be precipitated out. So the solution is no longer saturated now with hemihydrate, and it will be continuing to dissolve further. So that process will be continuing until no further dihydrate precipitate out of the solution. So this is how the mechanism of the setting of the gypsum works, right? So initially there is an induction period where there is a little or no rise in temperature, but when the reaction proceeds, gypsum is formed in the form of needle like crystals called sphalerite. Now we can see there will be different types of the crystal depending on the type of gypsum. So these are the crystals more irregular type seen in the plaster of Paris. These are more regular seen in the dental stone, and these are further more regular seen in the dye stone. These are somewhat cuboidal type of crystals. Now let's see the mixing of the gypsum products. So the manipulation basically, so the armamentarium will be the flexible rubber bowl, as well as you will require the stiff bladed spatula. Now the procedure, if you are doing the hand mixing, so you have to be very careful about the water powder ratio, and you have to take the water first before dispensing the powder into the bowl. Why? Because sometimes the powder will adhere to the walls of the bowls, and there will be change in the water powder ratio, and there are certain times where that the some of the particles of the powders are not wetted enough with the water. So always take the water. After you have taken the water in appropriate amount, then you have to take the appropriate amount of that particular product which you are going to use. So the hemihydrate, whatever, whether it's plaster or stone, right? After that, you have to leave the solution for 30 seconds as it is, so that every particles is wetted, and then vigorously you have to spatulate the whole area. You have to mix it vigorously, and you have to make sure that there is no lumps which are being formed while mixing. So you have to be very careful about the mixing, and then you should mix until you get the smooth creamy mix, and the spatulation should be complete within 45 seconds, and you have to be very careful that you do not entrap air. So to avoid the entrapment of the air after mixing, you have to tap the bowl. So tapping is done to avoid the mixing. Now the figure shows the apparatus used for mechanical mixing of the gypsum products. Now let's discuss about the different type of times for the gypsum products. So the setting time, mixing time, and working times are important times which we have to remember for gypsum products. So the setting time, what does that mean? That simply means that the time that elapses from the beginning of the mixing until the material hardens. So this is called the setting time. Then what is mixing time, which is the time available which is there for the mixing itself, right? So time from the addition of the powder to the water, of course we are taking water first, then we'll be adding the powder to it, and from that your clock starts, and it is the time until mixing is complete, until you get the homogeneous smooth mix, and this is generally one time for these products. Then the working time, now this is the time which is available to work with the mixture, right? So whatever work we are intending it, right? So whatever is our intention for using that particular plaster of Paris or dental plaster, and it should have the homogeneous consistency till our work is finished, right? So this is called the working time, of course. So the time which is available to work with the mixture for intended purpose, and it is that time that maintains an even consistency of the solution. So at the end of the working period, material thickens and no longer workability is there. So that's why we have to finish the workability before the changes of the consistency of the product itself, right? So a working time of around 3 minutes is usually sufficient for these products. Now let's see the setting time. So there are two setting times we have, the initial setting time and the final setting time. So the initial setting time, as the reaction will be proceeding, more hemihydrate crystals will be reacting to form the dihydrate crystals, and the viscosity of the mass will be increased, and impression after the initial setting time can no longer be poured. So the material becomes rigid, right? So it can be, of course, it can be carved or scrapped off basically, but you cannot mold it, and this is known as the initial setting time. Then we have the final setting time. This is the time at which the material can be separated from the impression without any distortion or fracture. Now there are various methods of measuring the setting times. These are the loss of gloss method, then exothermic reaction, and penetration test. So first we'll discuss the penetration methods. So the first one here is the Wicket's needle or Wicket's apparatus. So we can see this is the Wicket's apparatus, right? And this is the Wicket's needle. So what happens, basically the needle weighs 300 gram or the diameter is around 1 mm, right? Now the time that elapses from the starting of the mixing till the Wicket's needle is not able to penetrate till the bottom of the plaster is known as the setting time, right? So the setting time, which is obtained either from the Wicket's needle method or from the Gilmour's method, both are equal. Now the another penetration test or method is the Gilmour's method, right? So it is of two type. Basically it uses, one uses small needle and the another one is using large needle. So these are the needles here in the Gilmour's method, right? So the small unit or the small needle will be requiring will be having a diameter of 1 by 12 inches, that is 2.12 mm, and the large needle will be having the diameter of 1 by 24 inches, that is 1.06 mm, and the weights will be 1 by 4 of lb and 1 lb for the large, and smaller will be having quarter lb weight, right? Now initial Gilmour method, it shows the initial setting time, and the final Gilmour method, it tells you the final setting time. Now let's see the various factors that affects the setting time. So the first factor here is the manufacturing process, then the mixing and spatulation, so that will be affecting both rate as well as time. Then we have the water powder ratio, the temperature, and the modifier chemicals which we are adding. So what are the modifiers which we can use? These can be the accelerator, they can accelerate the formation or setting of the gypsum, or they sometimes they can retard the setting of the gypsum, and that's why these are called as retarders. So starting with the accelerator, so these accelerators are basically finely powdered gypsum which are added by manufacturers to accelerate the setting time. So what is the function of these finely powdered gypsum particles? They simply act as the extra nuclei of the crystallization, right? So they will be providing more nuclei of crystallization, which will be further increasing the setting or decreasing the setting time, right? So the sodium or potassium sulfate can be act as the accelerator, and another example can be sodium chloride when used in 2 to 3% of percentage concentration. The various retarders for the setting of gypsum are the borax 1 to 2%, then we'll have the sodium chloride when used more than 3.4 to 20%, acetate, borate, and the citrate, then gelatin, ghee, and agar. These are the these all retard the reaction of the setting reaction of the gypsum, basically, right? Now other gypsum products, the orthodontic stones, then we'll have the resin modified stones, mounting plasters, and fast setting stones. So these are certain example of other gypsum products which are available. Now coming to the meritors prefect, so here there is a comparison between the plaster and the stone. The first property we are comparing is the manufacturing method. So dry calcination is done for the plaster in an open kiln, while the stone we use the wet calcination. Since we use the wet calcination, that's why we call it hydrocal also, right? Now the particle and size shape, the particles are larger, irregular, and porous, right? So for these, but the stone are well groomed basically, so they have small particles, regular particles, and dense particles, right? These are densely packed basically. So the water powder ratio, it will be requiring more water because it was done by dry calcination, but it will be requiring less water because wet calcination was already being done for these. The porosity, it is generally porous since large particles are there and these are irregular, so there will be more voids between the particles, while here it will be denser because it is well managed, small, regular, and dense. Now the properties here, it will be having lower strength and hardness since it is porous, right? Now the greater strength will be there as well as hardness will be better here, right? Now what are the application of plaster and stone? So this is used when strength is not the primary importance, so it is used for the diagnostic cast, reading, and all. Then used when the greater strength and the hardness is required, as seen in the master cast. Now let's see the various properties of type 1 to 4. The water powder ratio here, it is 0.50 to 0.75 for type 1, 0.45 2.50. So this is the ml of the water that is required per 100 gram of powder, right? So for type 3 we'll have 0.28 to 0.30, type 4 0.22 to 0.24, and type 5 will be having the least water powder ratio, that is 0.18 to 0.22. So we can say that the water powder, when we move down to from type 1 to type 5, the water powder ratio decreases. Again, you have to remember these old values because they can also be asked directly in your exam. Then the compressive strength, the type 1 will be the impression material, of course, so 8.80 MPa is there. Then 9.3 MPa is for the type 2, the dental plaster. Dental stone or the type 3 will have 20 MPa. Then again the stronger one, 35 MPa for type 4, and the strongest one, 48 MPa for type 5. Now the setting expansion, so 0.15 will be maximum expansion for type 1. Actually we require the least setting expansion for the impression materials, but still we have to remember the least is here for type 4, okay? So this we have to remember and we should not get confused with 0.15. So type 1 will be having maximum setting expansion of 0.15, type 2 will be having 0.30, 0.20 for the type 3, and type 4 will be having least maximum expansion. But we want type 5 to have good strength, but at the same time that has to have more expansion. So that's why we call it high strength, high expansion. So these are for this 0.30 is the maximum setting expansion with the type 5, right? So this is just for counteracting the casting shrinkage or the shrinkage during the heating of the metals. So it counteracts the shrinkage by the metals, right? Now the porosity here, it is high in type 1, high in type 2, moderate in type 3, and low in both type 4 and type 5. Abrasion resistance, low in type 1, low in type 2. Now the abrasion resistance is basically the hardness of that particular material. So these are less hard, of course they will be having low abrasion resistance. Moderate for the type 3 and type 4 and 5, since these are known as high strength, so these will be having high abrasion resistance also. Now this is a graph that shows the increasing order of compressive strength of different types of gypsum products. So type 1 has the least, then type 2, then we'll have the type 3, then type 4, and finally the maximum one is for type 5. So this is according to the ADA specification number 25, and it is in the wet condition 1 hour after the hand mixing. Now let's discuss certain frequently asked question on gypsum products. So the first question is the manufacture method of the manufacture of the dental plaster. So as we know, the dental plaster, that is the type 2 gypsum material, right? And this is done by dry calcination by an open heated method. Basically there is no closure here, and in the calcination, the temperature at which the gypsum is heated is around 110 to 130 degrees Celsius. So after that we get beta hemihydrate as the product, right? Now the size of wicket needle. Now this wicket needle or wicket apparatus is generally used to know the setting time of the gypsum. So the wicket needle that has a weight of around 300 gram and 1 mm diameter. Okay, so it is a method of the penetration test by which we penetrate the this needle into the gypsum product and will try to find the setting time. Now the compressive strength of the type 5 gypsum. So as we know, the type 5 gypsum is hard with high expansion. So that will be having around 48 MPa of the compressive strength. So that we have to remember. Gypsum product that requires minimum water powder ratio. Again, the minimum water powder ratio is required by type 5 gypsum. As we move down from type 1 to type 5, the water powder ratio keeps on decreasing. So that requires least water for reaction, basically, right? So this type 5, the water powder ratio is around 0.18 to 2-2. So these are certain important questions which can encounter in the exam.